first store, fuck your bitch in the clique you claim. West side, when we ride, come equipped with game. You claim to be a player, but I fucked your wife. We bust on bad boys, niggas fuck for life. Plus, Puffy trying to see me weak, hearts I rip. Biggie Smalls and Junior Mafia, some mark-ass bitches. We keep on coming while we running for your juice. Steady gunning, keep on busting at the fools. You know the rules, Lil Caesar, go ask your homie how I leave you. Cut your young ass up, leave you in peace. Now we deceased, Lil Kim, don't fuck around with real G's. Quick to snatch your ugly ass off the streets. So fuck peace, I let them niggas know it's all for life. Don't let the West Side ride the night. Bad boy murdered on wax and kill. Fuck with me and get your cat spill. You know.
So I put my hand.
Freestyle battle, all you niggas getting killed with your mouths open. Trying to come up off of me, you in the clouds open. Smoking vapors like a Sherman, niggas think they learn to fly. But they burn, motherfucker, you deserve to die. Talking about you getting money, but it's funny to me. All you niggas living bummy while you fucking with me. I'm a self-made millionaire, thug living out of prison, pistols in the air. Biggie, remember when I used to let you sleep on the couch and beg a bitch to let you sleep in the house? Now it's all about Versace, you copy my style. Five shots couldn't drop me, I took it in smell. Now I'm about to set the record straight. With my AK, I'm still the thug that you love to hate. Motherfucker,
so I hit him up.
Welcome to the goddamn Gabbin' Games, fellas. Good to see you. That is, of course, a copyright strike on my channel. I don't care. I don't care. It's Gabbin' Games Live. Good to see everybody. That was Miley Cyrus and Tupac Shakur mashing up the Party in the USA and Hit 'Em Up by Tupac. It's good stuff. It's good stuff. Welcome to Gabbin' Games. Welcome to the live version of the show. The live version of the show, as you may or may not know, is much more chat-centric. You can call on the phone. You can call on Discord. I'll look to the chat. I'll look to the Discord. Look, Nikki T's even asked me, what's the name of the fucking song? I just told you, Nikki T. Get on board, baby. So if you're looking for the more, you know, calm, I need some real reflection and analysis and philosophical angles on the video game news of the day and the week, that is just straight up Gabbin' and Games. You can find that on podcasts. You can find that here on YouTube. But from now on, when you see the thumbnail with the red background, that's a live show. When you see the thumbnail with the blue background, that's a show that's either just me and it's more calm and focused, or I have some guests from time to time and things like that. So just giving you a heads up, that's what's happening. Welcome to Gabbin' and Games. At the top of the show, I want to let you know two things. One is I was eating the Tootsie Roll Pop, and I'm a little sad to report that we are not going to have a great show, because the only time we ever have a great show is when I get the Tootsie Roll Pop with the Native American, Indigenous American, with the bow and arrow and the star, and alas, we did not get it. So hang in, folks. This show is going to be a rough one. Luca, thank you, buddy. I appreciate that. As a director, as a filmmaker who actually makes good-looking movies like you do, sir, that means a lot to me. Luca says, nice effort with the lighting, Jaffe. Mr. K has been a member for 12 months. He's also just been a goddamn great help, giving great advice. He's a piece of shit. He's a pain in my ass, but he's got good ideas, good advice. He drops in a chat. He says, confession, I say the N-word out loud when I'm singing along with music. That's fine with you. I don't. At all. I really don't. People are always surprised. Darth Nugget says, Mr. K, don't we all? I don't. And again, I don't care what you do, but people act like, oh, Jaffe, of course you do. I'm like, I don't want to say it. I don't even want to say it in private. Not because I'm like some baby or something, like, oh, I can't say it in private, but because I'm just like, it's such a nasty, hateful word that I'm just like, I want nothing to do with it. I want nothing to do with it. 7 of the 9. Thank you, buddy. He's been a Cult Calypso member for four goddamn months. That's very generous. Thank you, sir. He says, Jaffe, what edition of God of War Ragnarok are you pre-ordering? I ain't pre-ordering shit. I'm buying it digital the day it drops. Why the fuck would if you want a collector's edition, sweet. I did a video the other day. I think the God of War collector's edition is both of them are pretty not good. I wasn't impressed at all by the collector's edition. I thought the hammer looks, you know, we talked about it on the chat, kind of looks like a chew toy, and it's just not very impressive. And then there's no physical disc in there. Fuck you. I'm not doing it. I'm not going to pre-order a fucking game in this day and age, because most of my shit is digital. But it's great to hear you're going to be getting one of those doorstops. You're going to get the Jotunheim edition, which I don't think they've dropped a price yet for that. My guess tells me that is going to be probably what? The Horizon one was 200, so it's at least going to be 200, might be a little more. The top of the line one, it's probably going to be like 275 or something. Insane. But hey, your mileage will vary. And if you enjoy it, enjoy that shit, man. Little fuck boy. I think that's what the F stands for. Thank you for the super chat. He says, Jaffe, I want you to bump uglies with my wife. Sure. Send me a picture of her though. I mean, I don't mean that disrespectfully. Like, you know, it's all about the looks, but if you're offering me up your wife kind of in an indecent proposal, style way, it is going to all be about sort of the initial physical response to her. So send me a picture on the Discord or send me a link to her here. I'll put her up for everybody in the chat to look at. Again, it could, I mean, I'm not being misogynistic or disrespectful. I'm just saying that kind of proposition can't, because what am I going to do? Get to know her first? No, you're literally offering me sex with your wife. So let me see what she looks like. I'll let you know what I'm going to do. Brett Moore, thank you. Been a member for 5 goddamn months. He says, I'm Mike Bolton, turning the gangster rap down and rolling the window up. Brett Moore, you know I love you, buddy. I thank you for your generosity. I don't know what the fuck that means. I know Michael Bolton, but he says, I'm Mike Bolton, turning the gangster rap down and rolling the window up. I don't get the reference, sir. I'm an old goddamn man. Luca, thank you for the super chat. He says, I thought only Mr. K listens to country. I love country. I love rock pop country more, but it's good stuff. Mike Warner, we're about to get to the news, but I couldn't let it slip my attention that good sir Mike Warner has says, hey, I like you kids. You kids strike me as the kind of kids that'll get me in the good kind of trouble. I'm in. And he joins the Diet Soda Soldiers. Thank you, sir. I appreciate that. It's very generous. I'm going to show you a couple things I'm going to give you today. I'm going to give you a little bit of anal sex with Mickey Mouse. Oh, Mike Warner. And then I'm going to give you a smoke of the pipe. There you go, baby. Mike Warner, thank you so much for joining our little merry band of fucksticks. I appreciate it. Now, look. Listen to me. I want to talk to you about... before we get into the first news story of the day, which is, just give you a heads up, I got to show you some really cool, a really cool item that dropped, and then we're going to talk about Kojima. I got a knock at the door a few minutes ago, and it was a package, an express envelope, and it says, ship to eat, sleep, play. Well, I haven't been I don't even know if Eat Sleep Play is still a real company. And I signed exit papers from that company many, many years ago. I received I made a couple of deals with him. I said, look, if you guys ever sell the company, I want 100K. Okay, cool. And there was like three ideas that I had come up with that I said, I want to take those ideas. But everything else, you guys can have all my ownership and all that. So I don't know what the fuck I'm looking at. I'll let you guys know if it's something I can share. It's an unboxing of what feels like a legal document. It's an envelope addressed to me, care of Eat, Sleep, Play. I don't know what this fucking thing is. You want a hit of the fecal paste? You got to either join or give me a super chat, baby. What is this? Oh, I know what this is. Oh, I'm so happy. Okay, no, this, I still have a company credit card for Eat, Sleep, Play. It's, I mean, I pay it, it's my money and stuff, but it's just, I like the card. So I keep, keeping it alive, and, I lost it and they sent me a new one, but they, I guess they still think Eat, Sleep, Play's, working. There you go. That's what it is. All right, fellas, we're going to talk about Kojima in just 1 second. I do want to say Dominique Bonnet, you all so-and-so. Sexy, flirty name, Dominique Bonnet. It makes me want to dance. But it's funny to me. All you think is living bummy while you fucking with me. I'm a self-made millionaire. Thug living out. That's me dancing. Dominique Bonnet, here's a pope. A little smoke of the bubbly. I don't know. And, buddy, I appreciate it. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dominique Bonnet. Are you sure we're going to be able to take the castle? Oh, indeed, sir. Dominique Bonnet. The Dominique Bonnet is here? Yes, sir. He's brought his wolf dogs and his 6 virginal maidens. All these things apparently bring him superpowers that allow him to lead forces such as ours into the lion's den. Well, bring Dominique Bonnet up here before me. I want to talk to this man. I'll do my best. Okay. Let us begin. I wanted to show you something real quick. The live show, as you may or may not know, is much more... we're going to watch a couple of videos today. We're going to talk about news and stuff, but it's not as, you know, I don't care if you just drop in and out on this show because it doesn't have the same kind of, form fitting girdle, structure. But, I wanted to show you this. This is fucking cool, man. Look at this shit. Lego drops this
from the darkest corner of the Lego Super Mario universe.
Come on.
The mighty power.
Come on. Look at that. Hi, Carl.
Designer on Lego Super Mario.
Look at this goddamn giant fucking Bowser. Look how big this fucking thing is.
This model, we wanted to create the ultimate Bowser build. And that means we had to make it big.
Goddamn right. You goddamn right.
Bricks, the more details you can put
it's $300.
Besides capturing all of his iconic details, we also wanted to make him come alive. And what we did was add a couple buttons on the side where you can push to move his head back and forth.
Okay, okay.
Trigger to open and close his mouth.
Okay, does he roar?
And if you pull the trigger all the way, he'll actually shoot out his fireball.
Come on now. Come on. What do you mean they're not even real Legos?
From a few different forms of puppetry.
Fuck you.
And added loose joints to the legs and tail. So when you pick him up, he actually looks like he's jumping. Most of the Lego bricks used to make the Mighty Bowser are actually not designed to make characters.
Oh, well, there you go. There you go. You're right. They're not Lego, real Legos.
The fingers, the horn, and the edge of the shell, and our new 3x3x3 ogive. Most of the other bricks were made for cars and spaceships and vehicles and airplanes. All different types of machines, not characters.
Who gives a shit? It's cool.
My favorite part of this model has to be the shell. It was one of the first things.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. That is a pretty cool shell.
I love how it captures the curved shell edge and all of the hard facets and details of the shell itself, and just capping it off with our new 3x3x3 ogive. It looks super fun, and it is super fun to build.
I don't like his hipster mustache either, Darth Nugget.
The last thing we needed was a digital interaction with our Lego Mario.
Oh!
And that's where Didier came in.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Didier, Senior Interactive.
Hello, Didier!
I'm Mario, and I bring Lego Mario figure to life.
Oh, thank you! Thank you!
I joined this project when the physical model was...
If you're not watching and you're listening, I don't recommend that for this podcast, but if you're just listening, he's taken the little baby Mario Lego and put him right in front of Bowser, and we're going to see what's going to happen.
Nearly finished, and it looks...
Why is that man's jacket so small? Did somebody steal the bottom half of his jacket? That man chose to leave... Listen to this. Listen to this. That man chose to leave the house today and not just leave it and go about his day. He knew he was going to be on camera. So he's like, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to poof my hair up like that that enemy from that exercise kid show, Busy Town or whatever. I'm going to fuck with this mustache and look like a fucking crazy motherfucker. And then I'm going to rip off half my... This is a look. This is a fucking look. He went out of his way.
Amazing. We wanted the digital experience to match that epic...
Who's he looking at? Look at him looking. Who's he looking at over there? All right, let's see. Here we go. Here we go. Robbie Rutten. That's right. That's cool. Oh, that's cool. That's very cool.
If you like Lego bricks...
It's not $300 cool.
If you like Bowser, you're going to love this set.
If you like Ogives, you're going to love this set.
If you like stomping on Bowser, you're going to love this set.
Okay.
If you like tubes, you're probably going to like this set. What are you doing?
When do we stop?
You don't stop. You're not supposed to stop.
What are you doing? He's like, I'm getting ready for tonight. What do you mean? Come on. Look, come on.
When do we stop?
You don't stop. You're not supposed to stop. We cannot wait for fans to get their hands on the mighty Bowser.
We did it.
That's a great fucking toy, though. That's a great fucking toy. I don't do all that shit. I don't go in for that shit. Just because, you know... here's what it is. You get old enough and you have experiences, you have recollections of, it's like, you know what, man, I have moved around so many goddamn times that I know what it's like to have had a item that I was really excited about. And then when I move, I'm like, oh, fuck it. Just throw it in the goddamn trash. You know what I'm saying? So... It's cool. I like to look at it and appreciate it, but that's pretty much all it is. That's pretty cool, though. Goddamn $300 Bowser from the Lego people. That's pretty good stuff. I want to say Rory Grimshaw. Thank you, buddy. He's been a member for 4 months of the Diet Soda Soldiers. Thanks, sir. He says The Last of Us Part 1, which is the remake, remaster, whatever the fuck it's called, has gone gold. Can't wait to play one of my favorites ever with Last of Us 2 gameplay. PS code in the collector's edition is because of the PS5 digital. Now, the first part we'll get to, Rory. Thank you for the support, buddy. We'll get to The Last of Us Part 1 in just a little bit later in the show. I know that that is a prevailing theory, and it may actually be an accurate theory, which is to say that why for Horizon Forbidden West and now Ragnarok's collector's editions have a voucher for a digital code and not the actual game is because they did not want to... worry about the fact that some people have digital and some people have a disc version. And if you have the digital version, then they would obviously need either two SKUs or they would need to put the digital version in the box and a physical version and then somehow figure out how to cancel one of them. Like if you've activated one of them, the other one will never work. I don't know. The ideal scenario is there would be a couple of versions of the box, and it's like, hey, I want the physical game or I want the digital game. But just because they've split their market and said, hey, we're going to have some PS digitals and we're going to have some physical digitals, physical copies of the game, that's not, for me, a good enough explanation for why the collector's edition comes off as pretty fucking... paltry as fuck. Spazbo says his theory is they didn't want to have a free upgrade for PS5 if you own the PS4 disc. It could be that as well. It could be that as well. But yeah, I'm sorry. I don't think it's a good enough answer. I really don't. Mr. K says Aaron Hammond asked how to join. You mean like join this show? Well, I appreciate the question, sir. If you go to the bottom of this video, there's a thing, our link tree. There's a whole couple of links in there about membership. You can't miss them. Take a look. If you happen to be on your iPhone, though, you can only join the Gabin and Games community if you do it through Safari on your browser. So you have to watch this on Safari at the youtube.com actual site because Apple doesn't want to give them 30%. or give up their 30%. But other than that, that's all the details are in the link tree, and I appreciate you consider it. Thank you, pal. Very, very kind. Okay. Well, yeah, Mute Moses, somebody gift sub that fool. The problem with gift subs on YouTube is it's ridiculous. I can't point to that guy and say, fuck it, I'm feeling generous today. Let me give the guy a membership. I have to basically buy 5 memberships. And then they get randomly sent out to people that YouTube decides who are watching the show at the time. They think deserve a membership based on how long they watch and how much they comment. It's really dumb. Because what they're really saying is, hey, you might be a lurker. You might be shy. You might not like to engage much, but you're a big fucking fan of a specific YouTube channel. Nope, you don't get the free thing. Fuck you. I don't like it. I don't like it. Here's something else. I is a little weird. Hideo Kojima, we all know what happened. Somebody, some jokester, when Shinzo Abe, the ex-prime minister of Japan, was shot, killed last week, almost immediately, and you can kind of see in the footage, they tackled the guy who was a member or an ex-member of the Japanese Navy. He built his own weapon to kill this guy. It wasn't political. He said he did it because Abe's policies or his contributions or support of a specific weird religious cult caused his mother to lose all of her money, whatever. They tackle him to the ground, and there's a shot where you can kind of see his face, and he kind of sort of does look like Hideo Kojima. Well, somebody took that, and it was clearly meant to be a joke. You know the story. And they said, oh, it's this guy. And some of the news sources ran with it, right? Well, Kojima Productions is interesting. What do you mean? How it's not political wiki in the sense that it's not about the policies he enacted when he was prime minister. It's about money that he has gotten and contributed or what have you to this particular religion slash cult. So he's not like going, I didn't like what he did when he was prime minister those couple of times. But Kojima Productions, they're not happy. And they say, they release this tweet. Kojima Productions strongly condemns the spread of fake news and rumors that convey false information. We do not tolerate such libel and will consider taking legal action in some cases. Fine. That is, of course, Kojima's right. But I would just like to say briefly that I'm just like, come on, man. It may be different because it was his ex-prime minister. Maybe if it was Obama, or for you people who like Trump, or W. Bush or Clinton, maybe because you have a patriotic cultural connection to these people, it hits harder, right? But that aside, and I can't say if that's true for Kojima, this is brilliant. This is like, I mean, it's tragic the guy got shot. I'm not saying that's brilliant, but I'm like, what more does Kojima need to solidify his place amongst the pop culture gods of video games than it's like, oh yeah, here's some trivia. He was accused of assassinating the prime minister of Japan and people thought he really did. Come on. That's you pay for PR like that. God damn. So I think it's a little weird that they would consider, thinking this is a libel case, a case where they defamed him, but you know, it's probably extremely bad in Japanese culture, says William. Well, that's what I'm saying. It's either a Japanese cultural thing or it's the fact that he was a Japanese prime minister. And maybe the same would go if, Cliff Bleszinski was accused of assassinating, Bill Clinton, and it clearly wasn't Cliff. Maybe because he is an American president and most of us watching the show and I am American, maybe then it would, I can't figure out how much of it is tied to the fact that he's Japanese and it's his prime minister, or maybe it is just a cultural thing and it wouldn't make a difference if it happened in America. Addy Pie says, because it's a really bad look in Japan. Yeah, but why? Is it a bad look because he was the prime minister, or a bad look because it's more of a cultural thing? Okay. Cab is asking me, Jeeves says they besmirched his honor. Yeah. I wouldn't. Okay. So, A cab says, Jaffe, do you worship Kojima? No, I do not worship Kojima, but I will tell you that I'm a big fucking fan of Kojima. Absolutely. Even Death Stranding, which I don't think in my entire life, if I live to 100, I will ever go back and play. I even like that. It was a little too slow for me. We now interrupt this stream, and I'm not fucking with you. This is not, we're going to get to all of its video game news today, but I have to tell you, Julio Araúz hit me up and reminded me just now of some breaking news. I'm not even fucking with you. I'm going to go ahead and type it in. The first images of the Webb Telescope, which is the most powerful telescope in the history of humanity, Joe Biden just released the first one, and tomorrow NASA's going to release a bunch other ones. I just want to see what they look like real quick. So let me put that up on the screen. NASA, Biden, Webb Telescope. Let's just look at it together, and then we will get back to our show.
Nope.
Excuse me, fellas. This is what we're seeing. President Biden reveals James Webb Space Telescope's first stunning image. A massive group of galaxy clusters act as a magnifying glass for the objects behind them, including faint, distant galaxies. I want to make it big. I want to blow it up. I don't want to look at that fucking little tiny thing. Why can't I make it big, man? I want to see it. I want to see it big. Let's see this. Ooh, there we go. That's a little better. Ooh, that's a lot better. Look at that. Those are not Christmas lights. Those are not Christmas lights. That is our, not even our universe. That's just part of our universe, or our ability to see that part. Look at this one up here. Look at these fucking things, man. Look at that. That's a fucking galaxy. That's a fucking galaxy. I don't know. That's another fucking galaxy. That's another fucking galaxy. That's another fucking galaxy. My God, people. My God, people. I mean, it's staggering, the scale of this experience that we have come to. And I honestly think the job is to survive long enough to get off planet, transfer our consciousness to machines, and ultimately, this is just like a world map in Elden Ring. Ultimately, we will explore it, colonize it. It's staggering. Your mind reels. If you really take in the time to think about space and think, it's delightful. It's delightful. No, this was not the Hubble telescope, Amon. This is from the James Webb telescope, which is the most powerful telescope ever. Okay. The galaxies form 300,000 years. The universe is older, says Fairly Racist. Yeah, I don't know. What do you mean it's fake? Fuck you, motherfucker. There's nothing fake about it. Why would it be fake? Okay. Well, that's Fairly Racist. Been a member for 21 months. God damn, that's a lot of generosity. Thank you, sir. He says, people should assume to solve any mystery, question, or sum is Kojima. Wait. Oh. People should assume the solve to any mystery, question, or sum is Kojima. That's right. You should put that in all your answers when you're a kid on your test, and you should say that he's the guy who killed JonBenet Ramsey. He is always the go-to guy who did the dirty deed. Absolutely true. Okay, let's move on. Let's get to some other news. I appreciate it, fellas. Doesn't this make you feel more in God or... Oh, does it make me believe in a God or a creator? The thing you have to understand, and it's a free form show, so we go off the rails sometimes. We'll get back to the games. We're going to talk about PlayStation in just a second. The thing you have to understand, Amon, is I am agnostic. I am not atheist. I mean, I'm atheist agnostic. I am 100% atheist when it comes to Judeo-Christian Muslim beliefs in terms of their take on the literal take of the universe. No, I don't believe in any of that stuff. Do I believe it's possible there may be a consciousness that had a hand, if not an entire, desire and intention of creating the universe and us? Sure, that's possible. It's also possible that because the way our brains have naturally evolved, we have to search for meaning in patterns where there are none. And that is a natural conclusion that we would come to. But another species that could have evolved differently, but could still think, if you ask them, they might go, oh yeah, that would never occur to us. So I refuse to say I refuse to plant a flag about what the universe is without taking into effect the very nature of being human automatically and impossible to stop, views it through a filter. And that filter already has preconceived concepts of what normal and what expected is. So there's my answer. Salah Kev says, thank you for the super chat, buddy. He says, Last of Us Remake should be faithful and not like Final Fantasy VII R. Well, let's be clear. It's a remake, but it's a remaster. They're not going back and redoing the whole fucking thing. They're going back and making the same game, but they're bringing it up to standards of Last of Us II. It's not like they're basically reimagining it. So I don't think you have to worry about that. Thank you for the super chat. Okay, let's move forward. PlayStation 5. I want to talk about that. There's some new numbers that came out. Oh, yeah, there's more than one universe. Absolutely. PlayStation 5. Figures came out. Now, this is VG Charts. VG Charts is historically not correct in terms of specifics, but they tend to be always correct in terms of the overall concept, like the percentage variance of between sales between consoles and whatnot. They just get some of the numbers wrong because they don't have all the data that like NPD has and things like that. So at least that's what I understand. So at the top of the heap, we have Nintendo as the best-selling console. They've sold over almost 110 million units in their lifetime across the world. PS5 is up to 20 million units, and Xbox XS has sold 16 million units. So, you know, that I'll tell you what. I mean, I'm not even fucking with you. Can you imagine? Think Microsoft has all the fucking money in the world. Can you fucking imagine? Here, I'll show the chart up while we're talking. Can you fucking imagine if they would have gone to Shannon, Shuhei, Scott Rohde, Connie Booth, maybe Herman, just the you know, this group of executives that know how to get this shit done. And they would have said, look, we're going to give you a salary of, you know, $650K a year. We're going to give you some fucking crackerjack bonuses. And if you turn this ship around for us, you're going to get richer than you ever hoped to get. Okay. Stocks or what have you, bonuses. The Xbox would be unstoppable, right? If Xbox was actually had been able to fulfill the vision of Phil Spencer that he has pitched to us over the years, my goodness gracious, this 4 million deficit between hardware would not exist. PlayStation would have been left in the dust because Halo would be phenomenal. You'd have Forza, you'd have Starfield coming, and it would be like the dream. I don't know why they haven't done that, made those offers. I got to get the phone. One sec. Sorry. Brian K says, I don't think so. Xbox has a stigma in much of the world. Again, all that goes away. All that goes away, Brian K, because the proof will be in the pudding. Again, I'm not going to get on that. You know my complaint about Phil Spencer's management, Matt Booty's management, whatever. I'm just saying, if you're Xbox and you want to succeed, and how could they not want to succeed? Jesus Christ, man. The people who can do this for you are out there. Start a fucking bidding war. Annie G has joined the Diet Soda Soldiers. Annie G's come over. She says, I put on my stockings and I put on my lipstick, Jeffy, and I want to come to this hoot nanny. And Annie G, baby, you are welcome to be here. You get a smoke at the pipe. It has a little bit of fungus in it, a little bit of weed, and a whole lot of love. I appreciate you being here. I appreciate your support, Annie G. Thank you so much, baby. Okay. When do you think Activision will close the deal, says Seven, to purchase Microsoft? Assuming nothing gets in the way, haven't they been predicting 2023? But I'm just saying what I've read on the internet. I don't really know. I don't have any insight into it. VVLM says Japanese don't like shooters in general. Well, we don't either. Mustafa says, man, we miss you. Can you make a new artistic video game? This is my new creation, this stream and this channel. I don't want to make games right now. I am working with Poland on a game. I'm consulting on a game they're doing, But short of that, I'm good. Listen to this. Speaking of other countries, we don't usually spend, I don't know, I feel bad about this. We don't usually spend a lot of time talking about the French when it comes to video games, do we? Do we? No, we don't. Well, I wanted to share with you the top five games in France this week because it was also on VG charts. And I figured, well, they deserve their place in the sun for all that they've given culture. Their number five game is Nintendo Sports Switch. That's still selling great for them over in France. Number four, oh God, so French. F1 22 for the PS5. Number three, F1 22 for the PS4. Number two is Horizon Forbidden West. It's still hanging out up there. The real trick about that one is we don't know how much of that has to do with the bundles, where they bundled it in to the hardware, which is much more available with that particular bundle, obviously, if you get it. That made no sense what I just said. I'm not an idiot. Most people would gloss over it and just go, I hope they didn't notice what I just said made no sense. I'm an honest fella. I'm a straight shooter. So I'll let you know what I was trying to say is we don't yet know if the current appearance of Horizon Forbidden West in the top three all over Europe has to do with amazing legs for the individual piece of software, or how much of it has to do with the fact that they are bundling it into a Horizon Forbidden West PS5 bundle. And for whatever reason, that particular bundle is selling really well. We don't know yet. They could have put fucking Gran Turismo in there or Knack in there. Who the fuck knows? Number one game over there is Mario Strikers Battle League Football. I do want to tell you one more thing really quickly about sales and stuff. I was talking to somebody who would know this because on one of our previous streams, we were discussing and debating and trying to figure out. Fuck was that noise? That was me. We were trying to figure out. Was there some kind of chart we could see to determine what games were getting the most playtime and or downloads on PlayStation Plus now that PlayStation Plus has added more games and they've sweetened up the deal and all that shit? All I know right now, and I haven't been able to find any more fucking information, is that Spider-Man Miles Morales was the number one game the first weekend that was downloaded the most out of all the new games Sony had put up there. But it's really lame. I want to see where it is now. Like, I want to see, you know, them, you know, I want to see the charts, you know, moving around and battling. John Barnett says, what are the biggest games they've added? Well, again, if you look at when they relaunched PlayStation Plus, right? That's what I'm talking about. So I'm assuming a lot of new people coming in. So it was a lot of it was new to them. But PS Plus, is it the collection? PS Plus collection games list? Let's see. Because they added Miles Morales. They added another PS5 game, didn't they? Demon Souls they added, right. There was like three or four games that got added, but I don't really remember what they were. So we'll see. We'll see if they ever release that data. I would love to know how that's going. I want to show you something, and I want you to tell me. You need to be looking at your screen for this, so stop, you know, jerking off or whatever the fuck it is you do when you listen to this fucking show. Yeah, Alex Eddie says it was Demon Souls Remake. Demon Souls Remake, Miles Morales, and Returnal. Right. And then Death Stranding Director's Cut. There you go. Okay. I want to show you something on your TV screen there, and I want you to tell me, hey, it's Michael Does Life. Michael Does Life, if this is the real Michael Does Life, I called you on your show, and you were mean to me. I was like, hey, let's do shtick, Michael Does Life, and he's just like, I don't like anybody. I don't want to talk to you. And I'm like, is that his shtick? And people are like, no, dude, he's not doing his shtick with you. And I'm like, why? Why isn't Michael Does Life doing his shtick with me? I don't like that. I thought we would be, didn't that suck when you meet somebody and you think you'd be pals and it doesn't gel? You're like, oh, this guy and I are, we're weirdos and we're the fucking, you know, crazy fucks and we're idiots and shit like that. I think we'd get along. And then you meet that person and he's just like, fuck you, Jaffe. I'm like, oh. I want to show you something on your television screen. I want you to tell me if you know what you're looking at. He's an incel? I don't think he's an incel. What do you think you're looking at here on the goddamn cockadoodie TV screen? This is kind of cool. This is kind of cool. This is happening in Japan. And apparently it's doing pretty well. It's working. It's working. If you don't know, I'm just going to fucking go ahead and tell you. A company in Japan called Onken has created these hit point badges, right, that you wear while you're at work. And the idea is, I'll read you some of the article. This is from Sora News. It says, oftentimes, the expectation is if someone is indeed struggling with their assignments at work or projects, their coworkers will be able to pick up the fact through incidental chit-chat. Unfortunately, since Japanese cultural values stress the importance of an individual meeting their responsibilities to the group, many people are uncomfortable openly and directly telling their coworkers that they're having a hard time. Tokyo logistics and media company Onken has taken a cue from video game user interface design and created employee badges with RPG-style hit point gauges on them. Okay, so employees get three badges, a green one, completely full, a yellow one, and a critical condition one, which is red. Workers are at their own discretion whatever which badge they wear, allowing them to clearly but unobtrusively let their coworkers know how much capacity they have for extra assignments, overtime work, and the like. And when they ask them, someone is wearing a low hit point badge, do people actually treat them differently and extra kindly? And they're saying, yes, that's actually what's happening. So you know what would be great? Here's the story, if you don't believe me. I'm not making this fucking shit up. Eventually, this is going to be digital, right? I mean, eventually, it's going to be, okay, I can tell how stressed this person is. You can already really do that. Fuck you, Aldahari. That's stupid. Fuck you, motherfucker. It's not stupid. It's creative, and it's fucking cool. Yeah, Brett Moore says, give that man a Phoenix down, right? Can you imagine? Can you imagine if it's like, oh, you know, this thing will let us know if this guy or girl is in the zone, and it's based on their own technical, you know, or sort of analysis, not just what they choose. Come on, man, there'd be value in that. Oh yeah, when it goes digital, we'll get the Black Mirror episode. That's right. By the way, speaking of, I'm going to move on. I want to talk about video game journalists doing this thing I can't stand in a second. We'll get to Last of Us, I promise. There's a show on Netflix right now called, I think it's called The Future Of. And it's really interesting. It's called The Future Of, and then each episode is only about 20, 23 minutes. And they have like the future of dating, like online dating, the future of death, how, you know, the future of video games, the future of animals. There's like 12 in their first season. And what's really cool about it is they do two different things. They go the future of, and it's like the near future. So they tell you the future of video games for the next 10 years, right? And then the second part of the show is the far future of. And they go like 100, 500, 1,000 years in the future and tell you how we're going to deal with death and uploading consciousness and having AI chatbots and all this shit that reflect our dead loved ones. It's a great fucking show. So if you're curious about shit like that and you like shit like that, like I do, go watch it. It's on Netflix. It's called The Future Of. Annie G slides in with a very serious, important question. Annie G says, Jaffe, serious question. Do you reckon Jimmy Ryan puts the God of War hammer up his butthole? I'm assuming it's his butthole is what you mean. You don't mean his pee-pee hole. People do that. Right. I mean, I've seen those videos where dudes take not like skinny things, like fucking thick objects and stick them up there. Is it a urethra? Is that what it's called? Urethra Franklin or something? And that, you know, that's different. But I think you mean his butthole. Man, you never know. You never know who out there in the world likes to put things in their butthole. I for whatever reason, and I don't know why this is. I don't have any trauma that I'm aware of. But I like this. I like these emotes, Sergeant. There you go. I don't have any awareness of any trauma. Okay. I'm just saying that I've never sought or desired or had the pleasure of things going in my butthole. Poop comes out of there. And that's what it does. That's why it exists for me. Right. None Your Business says the butt is exit only. Right. I don't want to put things up there, but people put shit up there all the time. Not shit, but other things up there all the time. And then it makes you wonder. It makes you go, wow, if you go into a business meeting and Jim Ryan sitting at the head of the table, let's do a Google search for percentage of people who put things up their butt. What is the percentage of people who put things up their butt? The many reasons, why do people stick objects up their butts? How often Americans have anal sex? Why do men put things up their bum? I need a percentage. U.S. stats. U.S. stats reveal objects people get stuck up their penis, vagina, and rectum. Oh, he done so delighted. Here we go. I want a chart. Where's the study? I want the study. Here we go. Emergency room visits database. Collection of surprising objects. Ooh! Man gets eel stuck up his bum. Refuses to tell doctors how it got there. Well, what do you think? Says, another man found himself in a hospital after his friend shoved a live eel up his anus for a prank. Well, what I like about that is it was a prank. Yeah, Simium says a surfing accident. I like how it was a prank, but it's like, was it like the prank was the eel, but putting something up their butt was not. So it's like, fellas, come on, it's 10 o'clock. You guys said you'd put some ice cubes up my anus. All right, Tim. All right, bend over. We'll do it. And then the prank part was, it was an eel. I don't know. Just befriend an ER nurse and they'll tell you how often people come in with stuff stuck in their bum hole. That's true. He slipped and sat on it. Yeah. Okay, let's move forward, shall we? I want to tell you something. In our very own Switch, I don't know if Switch is watching right now, but I will read you two comments. I got to preface this. And I want to make myself clear. I think life is tough. I think any and every time you can get a job that moves you towards your dream job or puts you in your dream job, brilliant. Never settle for any reason if it doesn't feel right for you. Always jump. Okay, so I am not shaming people who say, I'm a game journalist and now I want to go into video game development. That's fine. People, I've changed careers. There's nothing shameful about it. There's nothing to mock about it. But what comes up is the frequency that you see games journalists jump from video game coverage to video game creation and or writing and or social media or whatever, is concerning a little bit to me. And I'll read you, before I tell you some of the news that triggered this. This is Switch, our very own Switch, saying, he tweeted this the other day. He says, honestly, seeing game journalists end up doing PR communications for a studio or publisher reminds me of the revolving door between lobbyists and government officials. How do we know you're not pulling your punches in hopes of landing a comfy job? It's true. And again, I know a lot of these entertainment journalists don't care.
Thank you.
Look what, hey, you want to come be on camera? You want to come talk to people? She don't want to be on camera. She brought me the animal crackers. Oh, look what she brought me. She's like, I'll give you some of these crackers. When I feed my dog animal crackers, is that cannibalism? I don't know. How do we know you're not pulling punches in the hopes of landing a comfy job? Yeah. Right? And again, it's not that these guys are on some kind of, you know, they're not covering Watergate or the January 6th commission or the hearings. They're covering, oh, look, there's a delay in Halo's co-op today or whatever, right? So I get it. I get it. But at the same time, though, you know, it just, for them to lecture on crunch and for them to be all, take my opinion seriously. And then a lot of them turn around 5 days later and they're working on the fucking, they're working for these companies they're supposed to be covering neutrally. I don't know. And I'm not saying people aren't capable of doing it neutrally. Sure they are. But it's just, it's, I don't like it. It's not a good look. Here's the reason this is on my mind. Two things happened this week. Lucy O'Brien, who I got no dog in any fight with. I don't know her. She was the direct, she's the ex-IGN. I want to say she was the ex-IGN editor, but she was somebody over at IGN that covered stories and made big decisions. Okay. Lucy O'Brien tweets out, stoked to finally announce I've joined the incredible team at Ubisoft. You know, Ubisoft, the company that, you know, has a toxic work environment and sexual harassment and all kinds of things coming from the up, going all the way down. The company that independent companies over in France did research and said, we don't think they've improved any of the shit they're claiming to improve. The very Ubisoft that IGN has covered with those stories. She says, I'm finally excited to announce I've joined the incredible team at Ubisoft as director of editorial communications. The internal editorial team is stupidly talented, and it's an honor to jump aboard the ship. Huh. Huh. Here's another one. Now, I don't know this guy. This guy does a lot of stuff with Kind of Funny. A guy named Paris somebody. You guys know Paris has a great fucking voice. I wish I had that man's voice. It's phenomenal. But he says this. He tweets this the other day. He says, bookmark this tweet. A year from now, I will be working in the gaming industry. It's long overdue. I make this a reality. And I'm just like, dude. Yeah, he's host and creator for Kind of Funny and Gamertag Radio. And again, I'm not saying anything's wrong with Paris specifically or Lucy specifically going, I want to get out of this career and I want to go into this other career. I did it. People do it all the time. But it's just, it's so pervasive that it does make you go, guys, you know, really, it just feels... feels a little suspect. Right. Shorecat says that tweet was like something you say internally. Isn't it weird journalists call this stuff out on the end, joining the company they complained about? That's what I'm saying. It just feels strange. Novodamas, who I can't say where they work, but they would work in a place where this comment makes sense. He says, I've seen this firsthand, Jaffe. It feels weird to me too. Right. VV says the trick is they know people working on the big game sites and are getting paid to get the game covered. Brett Moore says, I see it both ways. I'm sure hardcore fans start in journalism to get into dev work, but I can see how some abuse it. Why would you start in journalism to get into dev work? That makes it sound like you're starting at the bottom. Journalism is a noble, amazing, valuable profession, much more valuable than video game creation. It's not, it shouldn't be the mailroom at William Morris Agency. It should be its own track. It's ridiculous to me. But on the plus side, though, listen, what's the guy's name? He used to be on 1UP. Eric, it's not Eric Luke, it's Luke Smith, right? And I talked a little bit with Luke Smith when I was doing some God of War stuff and he was still there. But to his credit, he's one of these journalists that moved over to development. He is now, and he's been the creative director of Destiny 2, and people think Destiny 2 is fucking phenomenal. So I'm not saying they can't contribute and be great and move on to a career that better suits them. Muppet Joe says Paris works in IT, cybersecurity. He wants to work in gaming. I understand. But he also works with he gets a paycheck, I imagine, from Kind of Funny. And he also is known to people because of his, I don't know if you call him a journalist, but, you know, whatever, journalist reporting, what have you. It just seems, you know, it seems a little weird, especially coming right on the hills of this Lucy lady, Lucy O'Brien. Rory says, Jaffe, what happened to getting Alana Pierce on? Yeah, I've seen some people saying, Jaffe, you should interview Alana. I'd love to interview Alana. And I talk to Alana from time to time on Twitter. I have nothing against her, and I don't think she has anything against me. But she has literally said to me, she's like, look, man, you know, you would probably ask a bunch of questions that Sony doesn't want you to ask. And I'm like, well, yeah, but you don't have to be obligated to answer them. And it's like, yeah, but asking and not answering sometimes is a worse look than actually giving the answer that I'm not supposed to be giving. And I'm like, I can see that. I can see that. So I don't have any, I'll give you another example. I mean, I won't tell you the guy's name because he's a good guy, but he was going to come on the show. Big fucking whale, like not whale, like in microtransactions, but like in the industry. You're like, whoa, you got him. He just reached out and said, Jaffe, I think your fucking show's funny. I like it. I'm like, cool. You want to come on? He says, yeah. I said, I don't think PR is going to let you. He says, PR doesn't tell me what to do. I'll fucking do it. And I said, okay, I'll talk to you in a couple of weeks. I reached out to him a couple of weeks later. He's like, yeah, I just did this interview. PR wants to have a little distance between that interview and anything new. And sure, fine. Maybe that's absolutely 100% true, but I understand my quote brand, and I don't blame him. I don't blame him. Why is not answering bad? Because if I had Alana Pierce on the show, and I said, before they dropped the date, hey, Alana, I think this game is going to slip to 2023. What you think that's correct? Yeah. And unless she can come out with a definitive answer, which she couldn't because it wouldn't be her place to, anything she said would cause more problems than it's worth because she would have to dance around the question. And then it's like, oh, she didn't answer. Oh, was that a hint she was giving? On and on and on. So that's the thing. All right, let's move the fuck on. Let's move the fuck on. Ubisoft, the Ubisoft thing was interesting, but it stopped being interesting. But I'm glad though. Ubisoft originally, they're still doing this. They're still gonna, pull a bunch of their old online servers. But they also said that there were three single player games: Space Junkies, which is a VR game, Assassin's Creed Liberation HD, and Cylander 5. They said those games, if you have purchased and bought them, will also be pulled. You will not be able to play games that you have purchased. But then they backtracked a little bit ago and said, oh, we phrased that wrong. If you've bought the single player games, if there's any online aspects, those probably aren't going to be working, but you'll still be able to play the games that you have bought. So it really, evolved into, you know, pretty much nothing. 7 of 9 says, Jaffe, you should have Phil Spencer on here and ask him why they're having management issues. Yeah. Yeah. I'd love to. Caveman says, did you ever check out Skull and Bones? Yeah. In fact, you're a member, so you can find it. It's in the members only section. We watched the Skull and Bones launch day drop, reveal, all that shit the other day. And I wasn't too jazzed by it. You know what I've been watching is Our Flag Means Death. My son came to me and said, hey, dude, you gotta fucking watch this shit. And great. Great show. Really funny fucking show. Okay. There is a Microsoft. There is an Xbox Portable. I have it. It's called, here, I'll show it to you. Tim Sweeney scares me. He's too smart to talk to. This is the Microsoft Portable. I'm not even fucking with you. I sit on the toilet and I lay in bed and I play xCloud, which streams perfectly for me, on my backbone, and it's, you have a Microsoft Portable. It's insane. And you also have an Apple Arcade Portable, a Stadia Portable. And eventually I have to assume Sony's going to be bringing their PS Now premium collection streaming to phones as well. It's fantastic. It's absolutely a fantastic device. I love it. It doesn't feel janky. It doesn't feel like one of those crappy little peripherals. It's good stuff. Okay. Let's move forward, shall we? I missed Arthur Morgan's super chat. Thank you, buddy. Arthur Morgan says, Atreus must be having all kinds of fantasies through his mind, thinking about Thor's hammer. You know what I don't understand, sir? Thank you for the super chat, buddy. I appreciate that. here's what I understand. It's like, first off, you guys know me. I don't give a fuck if this guy is straight, gay, a, bi, fucks monkeys, fucks horses as he does in the actual myth. I don't care. People just leave people alone. Let them be happy fucking whoever the fuck they want. Okay. So I'm not saying this as a critique or defense of anybody's sexual preferences. It's not even preferences. That's a dumb way to put it. Sexual wiring, right? But whenever I say it, it's so funny how there are people who really, even though I'm totally trolling at this point, they get really mad. And I'm like, dude, shut up. What's the matter with you? What's the matter with you? How were you raised? Were you raised poorly? Were you ignored as a boy, as a girl? That this matters that much to you? If there's a care, I mean, let's just say it's true. I don't think it's true. I'm just teasing people. And I make it clear I'm teasing because I don't want to queer bait people. That I've learned my lesson on that. I didn't even know that was a thing until I did it. And I'm like, oh, I'm so fucking sorry. Because I do think representation absolutely matters. But in this case, I make it clear I'm kidding. What are you gonna do? Not play God of War? It's gonna make your play experience worse because one of the characters in the game who isn't even fucking real happens to like the cock and the vag, or just the cock and not the vag. I mean, really? What's the matter with you, son? I mean, seriously, what the fuck's the matter with you? And I'm looking at you in the camera and I'm saying, what? And I used to think these were trolls until I did an interview with this one guy in somewhere in South America. It was about Aloy and her not being attractive anymore. And I was like, okay, this guy has got to be taking the piss. He was serious. He was fucking serious with me about needing the girls in video games to be attractive to him. I'm like, man, you're unhinged, bitch. You are unfucking hinged. Okay. I want to show you this. Let's get to serious stuff like video game designs, right? I'm going to show, well, okay. We've talked a little bit about this, but it got some great clarification in a Patrick Klepek article on Vice. And his article was about how games can get noticed. Okay. Let me get this chat on the screen first. Jaffe, hypothetical. What if Alana Pierce gives a list of questions that you cannot ask her? Would that be something you'd be willing to follow? No, I would not do that. I would never do that. I never want, how do I put this? I don't need to do this show. I love doing this show. I want to do this show. I'm happier doing this than I was in 80% of my video game career. Okay. Part of what makes me happy about it is I know I'm putting out a product, whether it's good, bad, or average, that is genuine. I would never want anyone to come to an interview I do and go, oh, well, that's Jaffe's pulling his punches, or Jaffe can't ask this, that. I'll always be kind to people, but no fucking way am I going to, because basically what is that, right? That's PR going, we want you to sell our game for us. And that's fine, but I'm not here to sell their fucking game. I am here to talk to people that I think are interesting, or that I think their takes on the industry or the art form are interesting. I would rather not do interviews than do that shit. I wasn't faking as a game creator, Armin. Faking what? I did the work. I didn't lie about the work, but 80% of the time it wasn't as fun as what I'm doing now. That's, I don't know what that faking is. Okay. So let's go to video game design real quickly. We're going to get to The Last of Us in just a second, but I want to tell you this story. This is really interesting to me. So there was a game that came out on Game Pass called Loot River. And I'll put up a trailer while we're talking just so you'll have an understanding of what it is. It was really clever, and it kind of reminded me of Hyper Light Drifter, but it had this cool mechanic, which was like, it was a rogue, or it was a Soulsborne-ish game, but it also most of it took place on these floating platforms, and you can move the platforms around like Tetris pieces. And you would be able to move a platform over to an enemy. If there was like six enemies, you could grab one enemy because he'd run after you on the platform and then move the platform away. So you only had to deal with him and not the other six. And it's very, very, very fucking clever. Okay. Like you can kind of see it happening there. And I was just kind of like, I really enjoyed it, but there were some real collision problems with it. I didn't play it for more than a couple of days, but the couple of days I played it, I was like, this is really fucking clever. Okay. Well, the article on Vice is talking about getting your games noticed and all this stuff. This is Klipek's article. And they interviewed these guys. And I just thought this was so interesting. Here's what they say. Loot River, the recent Tetris-inspired roguelike where players can shift pieces of the world around in real time, they released the game. Got a decent amount of attention when it was announced. This is directly from Vice. With its first trailer being viewed more than 500,000 times, the developer later signed a deal to be on Game Pass. It was even played by someone named Iron Pineapple, I don't know who that is, one of the most popular Souls creators on YouTube. But when the game came out in early May, the reaction was mixed at best. And then they spoke with the developers, and the developers in a Steam post said, to be honest, the launch didn't go as well as we hoped. The developers said they play tested the game ourselves and with a small group of devoted supporters, but this was a mistake. We did the demo version of Loot River in late December with very positive feedback. We launched in the evening, so I read a bunch of reviews like 8.5 from Game Informer and then saw the game had positive reviews on Steam and just broke into the top 10 global sellers. I went to sleep rather happy. I was not quite ready for the morning. They theorized the fans who showed up to help test the game in the game's Discord channel were already inclined to like it, which resulted in the developers tweaking the game in the direction of those players rather than the broader public. The result was waves of criticism, and more importantly, negative and mixed reviews on Steam that the developers have been trying to combat ever since. And this is a pretty cool image I want to show you. They put this image up showing every time they released a patch that addressed the user issues that they were seeing, the positivity rate went up. Okay. And I bring this up for two reasons. I bring it up because A, I know there's a lot of indie developers that watch this show, live or after the fact. And I also just think it's a fascinating part of the industry, which is play testing, not focus testing, so fucking important. It is so goddamn fucking important because, like they said, you get used to the game. The people who are already inclined to like you and like your stuff get used to the game. You become absolutely useless to this process. It reminds me, I talked a little bit about this a few weeks ago, the Twisted Metal Alliance. These guys were the hardest of the hardcore Twisted Metal players. They thought they knew it all. They thought they knew what the game needed and everyone should just shut up, including us, and just do what they said. And what they didn't understand is that you're not making the game for that little niche audience. You're trying to make the game, especially when they cost this much, for as many people as possible that are inclined to like the kind of game you're making. And so all I'm saying is if you're an indie developer or if you're a big developer and your company doesn't embrace playtest, figure out how to get them to embrace playtest. All the big companies do. I'd be stunned if yours doesn't. And I don't mean focus test. I mean playtest. But if you're a small developer and you've put all this love into your fucking game and you think it's ready to go and you haven't sent it out or brought people in, you know, that are total strangers who don't give a fuck about you, they don't want to impress you, they don't want a job with you, they don't want to fuck you, they're just there to play a game, get some pizza and $20 or whatever. If you haven't done that, you haven't finished developing your game, and you get what you fucking deserve. PTurtle says, Jaffe, I got to call in. What do you want to? I'm just gonna be straight with you, PTurtle, as I always am. Lately, people have told me PTurtle calls in, and it's just kind of, you know, it's there's a shtick, and I'm okay with the shtick. I love talking to you sometimes. But a lot of times I get people dropping off the show and going, oh, he just calls in to say confrontational what's the word I'm looking for? Controversial things, and we know where this is going, and can we just skip this and get back to the news? So if you have something serious to talk about or interesting to talk about, even if it is or isn't controversial, I'd love to have you call in. And I'll go into the thing right now. I'm putting myself in the Discord right now. But if you call in, and here we go again, I'm not being a dick. I'm just going to have to hang up. I hope you don't mind that. But I am in the I'm in the chat right now if you want to call in, man. I saved that. I want to talk before we get to The Last of Us. I want to talk about Capcom and EXOPRIMAL. Now, EXOPRIMAL held a network test over the weekend. I couldn't sign up for it. It was too late. They're also going to hold one, I think it's the weekend or July 25th, July 27th, and they're going to hold another one in early August. PTurtle, I'll get you in 1 second. Hang on. Let me do this story first. And so, you know, every time I've seen this game, and I consider myself a fan of what's the goddamn game with the giant insects? They made like 20 of them from Japan. Come on, man. Something the invade the earth. What the fuck is that thing called? Come on, man. Jaffe, I'm going to close my eyes and come up with it. And I'm going to open it and the chat will have told me, but I want to see if I can find it in my brain. It is called, hey, let's play Earth Defense Force. That's what it is. Earth Defense Force. And I like it, you know, and I like crazy, silly, stupid fucking games. And that's what this game has always looked like to me. Okay. And if you watch the trailers and all this stuff, it just looks like chaos, kind of like that game they put out on Game Pass, which was called Primal Extinction or something, which was a PvE, kind of like Left 4 Dead, but with dinosaurs. And so I like Capcom, but I'm like, whatever. And so I started watching some of these. There are people, the test was about an hour and a half long. So I watched a couple of these. And at first, most of the gameplay really was kind of indicative of what you see here. Just like a lot of fucking noise. Let me open this up for you. It wasn't Primal Rage. No, it was called like Extreme Extinction or Primal Extinction, something like that. But you know, if you watch this, it's just like a bunch of fucking crazy chaos, and you know, no thanks. I'll play it if it's free or something, but I'm not spending $60 on this, right? And when I watched this guy who did the stream this weekend, he was kind of saying, it's okay. It's maybe it depends. It'll be good if it's cheap enough, and he wasn't too excited by it. Sergeant, it might have been called Second Extinction. I don't know. It was a thing where you drop down to planets and fight dinosaurs with four other people or three other people. The one that was out. So I was like, whatever. I don't care. Okay. But then I watched, and this is a guy who was playing by himself, right? So I watched a guy here who was streaming it with a buddy of his. And it actually, they really enjoyed it a lot more. And it actually looked pretty fucking cool. It wasn't Lost Planet. It was absolutely not Lost Planet, what I'm thinking of anyway. And when you actually play it with someone else and you start to understand what the game is, I think Random Moose Brains got into the beta. I'm going to try to pitch this. And I'm sure if I'm not 100% right in describing this to you, I am 80% right. The game is kind of like Killzone 2 was the first game I ever saw in real time on the fly, change up your multiplayer objectives, right? This game is almost like what I saw these guys do is they dropped in and at first it was PvEvP, right? So it was all these dinosaurs dropping into the city and there was a team of four or five players. And that team had to kill the dinosaur number before the other team did. And you can kind of see it here. It's almost like a tug of war. It's like who can get the key dinos killed first. And yes, you can send people out and you can attack the other team as well. So it's not just fighting dinosaurs. It's also trying to stop the other team. I'm like, okay, that's fucking kind of cool. Well, then the team that won, I wasn't like, that's the most amazing thing ever, but I was like, okay, that's kind of cool, whatever. Then the team that won survived almost like a battle royale, and they got put into a match that was a total PvP match. And then they survived and they got put into another match with a different group that was about like in Team Fortress moving the object through the road and trying to get it to the end position before they were all killed, right? And it was this battle royale meets video game tropey modes changing in real time. And if your crew could survive that chapter, you all moved on. I'm assuming at the end it's all 1v1 and there's one win. I don't know if that's what it is, but that's very much what it seems like it is after watching people, these two people in particular, playing the network test. And I thought that was fucking cool. Here they are right now trying to, I think they're trying to be the first team to get to 100 dinosaurs. Random played it. Random, am I right? There was also a mode where both teams are grouped to fight a corrupted T-Rex that shot lasers. Yeah, pushing the payload. But Random, am I right in that if your team did well or survived, you moved on to a new battle? But if your team lost, you got separated and got sent back to the lobby? So there was kind of like a battle royale aspect to it in between modes? Because I think that's fucking cool, man. I pitched a game like that once. I mean, I didn't have the talent that Capcom or the execution that Capcom had, but I've always thought that was neat. And I'm like, oh, did somebody make that fucking thing? So I'm trying to find the payload version, but Random played it. He'll let us know in the chat if that's actually what happened. What's funny about, Dino Crisis though, is at the end of this, when you go into the, sort of the lobby or whatever, you can see the girl from Dino Crisis right there. So, I mean, they're clearly teasing it. I don't know if you can select her as a character or whatever. Random Moose Brain says, sort of. If you won, you went back to the lobby, and if you lost, you got eaten by dinosaurs. Yeah, but if you won, didn't you get put into a new match with your crew? But was it against a different team that had also won? And it was, you know, and if you lost, your crew got disbanded? I don't know. If that's what it is, it seems cool. But Random, you played it, though, and you said it was really fun. So I'm going to try to get into the future ones. This was a game that was totally not on my radar. Again, it's one of those things that, again, I'm not a big multiplayer guy anyway. But I am curious about it, and I will be playing this game if I can get into a beta. It's more like Anthem, says Random, in the sense you had objectives, and the faster you completed them, the faster you got sent to the final level. Okay. But you enjoyed it, right? Scale of 1 to 10, what was your fun factor, Random? If you had to give it a rating based on your fun factor, what would you give it? I'm going to close my eyes for 10 seconds. I'm going to center. I'm going to meditate. I'll come back. I'll get your numerical answer, and then I'll get to PTurtle, and we'll talk about The Last of Us. Here we go. I need 10 seconds, though, to recenter. He gives it an 8 out of 10. That's exciting. That's exciting. Could be a game night game. Cool. I'm in. All right. Let me bring in PTurtle real fast. See what he's on about. Hang on. God damn it. Come on now. Discord is getting harder and harder to navigate, man. Hang on, PTurtle. Oh my God. I don't care about new mentions. Fuck you. Leave me alone. I don't want to learn more. Get all your shit off my screen so I can move PTurtle where he needs to go. All right, PTurtle, it's Jaffe. What's up, man? PTurtle. The hell, baby? All right, well, you're on, PTurtle, if you want to talk. Have I checked out Arcadeageddon? I have not yet. I heard it wasn't very good, but you're saying it's actually worth checking out? Okay, cool. That's fantastic.
Hello?
Yeah, what's up, man?
What's going on, Jaffy?
You know, doing a show. What are you doing?
Laying down, looking at the TV. I got my ankle up. I just hurt my ankle.
What'd you do? Are you sticking it up your butthole?
I was what?
Were you sticking your ankle up your butthole?
No. Anyway, I just want to say, I don't do a shtick, first of all. I just want to make that clear.
Okay.
This is who I really am.
Okay. What do you want to talk about?
I know last time I called in a bit antagonistic because of the whole...
okay, but what do you want to talk about today? What do you want to talk about now, okay, PTurtle?
Two things real quick.
Mm-hmm.
First thing is, I don't appreciate you going around saying that for God of War... that Loki's going to be bisexual, like that's your idea. I made a bet with you about over a year ago.
Mm-hmm.
That's mine. You got to give me the credit for that.
You made a bet about what?
I told you that I knew, because this industry is so far gone and so progressive, that the next God of War game, they were going to make his son bisexual.
Why are you taking my idea?
Oh my God, are you serious? There's a video of it.
Hang on, someone's calling. Don't go anywhere, PTurtle.
Good Lord.
Hello? Hang on, fellas. Hello? Okay, hey, do me a favor. Let him know I'm currently live streaming. If he wants to call and talk to me while I'm on the live stream, we can do that. Otherwise, I can call him right back or call you guys back when I'm done streaming.
Okay, sounds good.
All right, but I would love him to call in live. You know I would. That'd be awesome.
I'll flag for him. Otherwise, I will send you a quick email and let you know.
Okay. It sounds perfect. Thank you so much. Bye-bye. I know my mic was on. That's the producer of the Twisted Metal TV series was calling. So I don't know if he's calling about going down to New Orleans or what. But all right, let me bring PTurtle back on. PTurtle, it's Jaffy.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, let's go. What's up?
You hear me?
Yeah.
Yes. I just wanted to say that was mine. Do you remember that? I made that prediction a year ago.
I don't remember it, but if you say it's yours, I believe you. You may.
That's where you got it from. Are you kidding me? Since then, you've been saying that.
Okay. All right. So what else you want?
I'll find the video and send it to you. The second thing is it's not relevant now as much as it would have been a few minutes ago, but I was going to talk about the whole Elena Pierce. And what's the girl from IGN's name? Lucy something?
Lucy. But who? Alana Pierce? What about Alana?
Well, I was going to talk about them in general and the gaming journalists that are now getting into gaming development.
Okay. Well, go ahead.
I was going to say that women, well, not women, because I don't want to start poking the bear, but these kind of people who get into this, they're going to ruin games. And can I tell you why?
These kind of people, what do you mean these people?
Progressive game journalists who care more about activism than gaming itself. They care less about the actual gameplay and they care more about whether it's a female character and what are they wearing.
Why do you think that's Alana Pierce? What has Alana Pierce ever said that suggests to you that she's that kind of human?
I've seen a bunch of videos about her talking about how men only care about how women look, even though she wears like 20,000 pounds of makeup. So it's like very, very hypocritical there.
Okay, so you worry that having a more diverse population in the creation process...
Not diverse. That's wizardry. That's not diverse.
You want to have wizards making games? There aren't real wizards, PTurtle.
What you're doing is wizardry trying to twist my words.
Okay, well then what is the kind of person you want out?
someone that cares more about the game and the gameplay rather than the shallow stuff like, oh, I wonder if a little girl's gonna like this character, or if this character's a good role model for gay people or whatever. You know what I'm saying?
Why can't both things happen at the same time?
Because one is a sacrifice, the other one is also alienating people. And the third thing really is that it takes precedence over the game all the time. How often do these woke games actually, how often are these sequels to these old games are actually better than their old ones? Gears is dead, Halo's dead. You know, I don't want to get into that again, but you know what I'm saying.
Okay, but I will say that, I mean, joking aside, I will say that, oh, that's bull. Day-Day Go Craze says it's ruining story. You guys, he says it's ruining storytelling. I will go fucking toe-to-toe with you, motherfucker, on storytelling. You cannot tell me it's ruining storytelling.
It absolutely is.
You don't know the first fucking thing about storytelling.
I don't know the first thing about fucking cooking, but I can tell you what a good dish tastes like.
Yes, but
that's just elitist, pompous talk.
It's not elitist, pompous talk. Here's what you're saying. Here's what you're saying. Like, take Gears of War. I like the latest Gears of War, but fine. Let's assume that Gears of War, one of the things you didn't like about it was it starred a female protagonist. That's fair. You have a right to your opinion. But there's nothing about that choice that affects the quality of the moment-to-moment or the meta gameplay. So they have nothing to do with each other. So what you're really saying is you are bothered by the way stories are being written in video games because you find that they maybe make you feel ignored or shamed, or they think you're a bad guy, but that's not the gameplay. That's not the actual product of the game. That's the intellectual property you're talking about, right?
For certain games, the story, the characters, and the world are the selling point. I'm gonna tell you right now, God of War 1 was a very good game, but the gameplay was never that good to me. It was fine.
Mm-hmm.
It was decent, but it was the character. It was that world. It was the adventure you were on. Now, if you turn that into this new Daddy Kratos on the road with his son, teaching him fucking lessons, it's not as cool anymore because I'm not going to run into an area where there's a fucking jacuzzi and I'm pressing circle fucking women. That's cool. That gives the game personality.
I played a game last year called Lust from Beyond where you can have orgies, you can get your dick sucked. It is super X-rated, and it on top of that, it happens to be a great first-person action puzzle game, action-adventure game. So okay. these games exist. Maybe the...
Well, we're talking about in the AAA space.
Well, tough.
It used to be a
my answer
game.
To you is... My answer to you, PTurtle, is tough. Because the fact of the matter is... The fact of the matter is... The games cost more than they ever have. These companies want to bring in as many people as possible.
Sure.
People like you who have a problem... They're not the number of people they're alienating is dwarfed by the number of people that they're opening their arms to and saying, we will include you.
Let me say this real quick.
Last thing.
Then let me get to the main thing I wanted to say.
This is not the main thing. This is like eating dinner and I've eaten a whole pizza and it's like, oh, how was the appetizer? I'm like, that was the...
All I was going to say about the Lucio Ryan girl, because you went on the other girl, whatever her name is, the Elena Pierce girl. What I wanted to say about the Lucio Ryan girl is that I remember back in 2014-ish, I think?
Yep.
When Kojima, who's the greatest game developer of all time, and you should take notes,
He was probably going to jail because he killed somebody, I heard.
That's funny. But when he put out Metal Gear Solid 5 Ground Zeroes,
yeah,
that game is very, very raunchy. I'm actually surprised that game.
Metal Gear Solid 5, was that called Ground Zeroes?
Ground Zeroes, though. It was the prologue.
Oh, right. Yeah. Okay. Yeah,
that game was very dark. It has rape. It's bloody. It's brutal. I think it has molestation, has everything. She put up an article, you know, really shitting on the game. Kojima saying that this is, you know, tasteless, it's dangerous, whatever.
Uh-huh.
And I'm saying now I have to worry. Well, she was really worried about a female character in their pause who's raped, and she was focused on that in the article and saying, you know, this is not very good or whatever.
Okay.
And it's worrying now when you have somebody like that, somebody like Elena Pierce, who are getting into now AAA gaming, who are going to be working on these stories when they are so far in the other direction of what.
Let me ask you this. Let me ask you this question. Are you a conservative or a progressive?
Honestly, I believe I don't really have a label, if I'm being honest.
Do you believe in the free? Do you believe in the free market?
Yeah, of course I do.
Okay, so if you're right, these companies will go out of business or they'll be forced to change. But so far, Sony's making more money than they ever have with this stuff. So what do you have to say about that?
You said Sony's making more money than they've ever made?
Well, this new God of War sold way more than any of the other God of Wars.
Well, to me, for somebody like me, the new God of War was the least progressive.
But it was the most the new God of War was the least progressive?
It was of like their new IP. I thought it was the least progressive. I thought
okay, but the point
is, I don't think there was a single gay character in that game, right? As far as I know.
Oh, every character in that game is gay. God of War, the new one.
Like, you play Ghost of Tsushima, there's a lot of gay side characters.
But God of War 2018 is a metaphor for coming out of the closet. It's totally gay. Every character in that game is gay.
That was true. I wouldn't be surprised if that was true. And the sequel will have a bisexual Loki.
Corey said to me.
Absolutely will.
Corey said to me, he said, when you, there's a certain, and I could not make heads or tails out of that, RPG aspect of the game. It was very confusing, but he said there's actually a certain configuration of armor and weapons, and depending on where you put certain upgrade points, where if you do it that way, it will actually, the game is capable, because of the power of PS5, of turning you gay.
Well, with DualSense, you might be able to feel when
most okay, of that, the hard. You've gone a little bit around the bend. Thank you for calling, sir. I'll talk to you later, PTurtle. Always good to talk to you, sir. There he goes, fellas. End of the night. That was our good friend, PTurtle. Okay. Sorry. Hang on. There goes PTurtle. Oh, shit. Okay, here we go. I want to talk about, obviously we need to get to some very important conversation about The Last of Us, which we will. I do want to show you the screen first, though. This is our link tree. If you're curious about our link tree, you can find it below this very video. These are some of the members that have businesses that are really fucking cool, and they sponsor the show. We talked on the last show about Icon Era. We talked about Kiska. Can never say it. But I want to let you know about some of these other guys real quick. The Leadist. You should check them out. They are a video game podcast that is all about video games and trivia. So it's a game show about video games. It is awesome. Go check out The Leadist. You can find them on our link tree. Go check out Spazbo, our very own Spazbo's World of Long Plays over on YouTube. They've been around for 15 years. They play video games that are absolutely, there's no commentary. They're played by a lot of players who are genuinely great at the art of playing video games. They record them. They go all the way back to the C64 era. It is like a fucking treasure trove of the art form. Check those fuckers out. It's good people. And then the last thing right now I'll tell you about is I want you to know, people always say, Jaffe, why don't I have a God of War hat? I don't know. Maybe you could go to the God of War, to the Gavin Games merch store. It's not a God of War hat. It's a twist mill hat. Sweet Tooth ice cream treats. Get your own for $24. We're always putting new stuff in there. Nobody's bought this one. There's only 5 of them you can buy. I'm stunned no one's ever bought this one. Who wouldn't want to go on a date wearing that shirt? Come on now. But anyway, there you go. These are the people who keep the show alive, and I sure do fucking appreciate it. Thank you, fellas. Very, very goddamn much. We are now going to talk about The Last of Us, okay? As we get in to that, I'm going to put some things on the screen, okay? It's not going to interfere with our conversation, but I think you should know these people. Rocking across your screen right now is good Sir Sam Bridges of Kojima's Connecticut, Sam Bridges. These are our Cult of Calypso members. This is not quite updated. I need to update this, but these fellas are our second line of defense and fighting the bad guys of the world. I appreciate it, fellas. And then as we jump to talk about The Last of Us, I want to let you know that these guys, really are our God of War teammates who make a lot of this shit possible. And I sure do appreciate it, fellas. Okay, so The Last of Us, Haley Gold, you can contact me on Discord or Twitter. Haley Gold. Is your last name really Gold? That's fun. Okay. And thank you to all you guys. All these folks moving across the screen. Let me give them their proper due. Let me get rid of these ads at the bottom. I'm one man band. No one's helping me with this shit. It's just me, baby. So The Last of Us Part 1, as you probably know, is the name of the remaster with a little hint of remake of The Last of Us 1. But it's being upgraded so it has better visuals, PS5 level visuals, as well as mechanics and controls and quality of life improvements that were brought to the series because of Last of Us Chapter 2. And I only bring it up because one of the animators who worked on the game, he used to work at the VASG group that Mike Mumbauer managed. You guys know Mike. He's now running Lithos with Johnny Garvin, making an interesting game. And then he since moved on to Bend, Oregon. And somebody, I don't know if somebody said this game was a cash grab or not, but I'm sure they have. But he put in his tweet the other day, "It's just a cash grab," in quotes. I don't know who he was attributing that to, but I'm assuming somebody said it. And his quote was something along the lines of, he's like, "This game is amazing. It is heartfelt. It is artistic. It is one of the most, incredibly executed games I've ever worked on in my career," blah, blah, blah. I just want to talk about that real quick, because I think it's funny that things can be a cash grab and still be great. I mean, every product in the world, for the most part, is a cash grab. When a little kid goes out and sets up a lemonade stand in front of her yard, that's cash grab, right? So let's kind of, at least understand what we're talking about. Everything's designed to make money in a business for the most part. And if it's not designed to make money, it's designed to build some sort of reputation that will eventually give you a warm, fuzzy feeling 6 months later, and they'll make their money then. Okay. Ace, what the fuck? It's just life, man. There's a noise on the street. Yes, you don't live in a spaceship. Fucking beautiful, sweet, loyal, moronic dog. Okay. Anyway, but I think what he was getting at, though, of course, is that this is a soulless attempt to just extract more money from our customers' pockets, and they really shouldn't be making this. Okay. And that's what I wanted to talk about. Right? Because, it did go gold today. They had an announcement. Let me show you right now. This is an announcement from Naughty Dog. "Thrilled to announce The Last of Us Part 1 has gone gold. Congrats to the dogs and our partners at PlayStation who contributed their passion and talent." And I think clearly it's really cool looking, right? It's really fucking cool looking to see this game brought up to modern day standards. That's neat. I didn't love The Last of Us Part 1. I adored The Last of Us Part 2, but I'll probably give it a shot. I'll probably give it a play. And then there was another news story that said Naughty Dog has reportedly been one of the industry's numerous crunch offenders, but on The Last of Us Part 1, devs say there was no crunch in the remake. Well, could that have maybe sort of something to do with the fact that they're making a game, they already know exactly what it is, it's already designed, it's already mocap for the most part. It's already, they've got all the sounds done. I'm not saying there wasn't any work, but when a studio comes to you, and I'm not saying Naughty Dog, if Naughty Dog doesn't crunch on their next original game, I'm going to be impressed. But let's just say that I'm not impressed that studios are working towards a crunch-free life. I think that's great if you can get it. But when you're making something new or you're trying to push the boundaries of what the first game did, you don't know what you don't know until you know it. That's just the way it is, right? So sure, if you're making, I heard people say Ratchet and Clank, the new one, which I love, fucking classic, didn't have a lot of crunch. Well, yeah, but you've been making that game for 20 years. And yeah, of course, there's different things and stuff, and it takes longer to make the art assets, but you knew what you were making, right? But if you go into something brand new, that shit is, that's where you get lost in the maze of fog and self-doubt and having to redo shit five times because what you thought was going to work didn't work, okay? But anyway, this is done. This is coming out in September. I'm excited to kind of keep an eye on it. But the real question is, that I have, is do we, when does this stop or does it not stop? Maybe the answer is it doesn't stop. Maybe the answer is when you have a game that a lot of people, rightly so, would consider a classic, which is The Last of Us Part One. Is that just the new thing you do? Is you continuously upgrade it and it never stops being fucked with because there's always new graphics, there's always a new audience? Or is there a point where you say, you know what, the team that made this, like, let me ask you this, I'll put a poll up in the chat. The team that made this, these guys, let's say they had two options. I'm not saying they did, but let's say these guys had two options. Well, Stoner Joe says Resident Evil 4 did. Resident Evil 4, that was such a jump from the first one, it makes sense. But this doesn't seem that, you know, necessary. But okay, if they came to this team and said, you guys can make The Last of Us Part 1, the remaster slash remake, or you guys can make a brand new 3-hour standalone Last of Us or Uncharted adventure that will go day one on PS Plus Essential or Premium or whatever the fuck it is. And it's like, here's a lost adventure between Nate and Sully. Oh, you know, whatever. Still great production value and all that, but it's not very long, but it's new content. Or even better, you guys have been kicking around this idea of a World War II ghost story for the longest time. Why don't you guys make like a prologue, make a 2-hour version, just like a teaser. Let's put it out there. If it catches on and people love it, we'll make a fucking full game about it. It just seems those resources, why are they spending them on this? Unless Jim Ryan's looking at it going, well, you dumb motherfucker, I'm spending it on this because I have guaranteed market research that says I'm going to make this profit with this game. I don't know what the World War II ghost story is going to do. I don't know. Let me put it in the chat. I'm going to put this poll up right now. Would you rather Indies Naughty Dog do Last of Us Part 1 remake master short form new IP or Uncharted short? Okay, here we go. Hey. Okay, here it comes. So it says new IP or Uncharted. Both those would be short. So this should be popping up there. Let me know what you guys think. I'm very curious about this because it does just seem weird that it's continuously the same goddamn thing. But maybe that's the business. Maybe that's the business we're in now. People are so in it, and it looks great. I mean, this is the new one. Check this shit out. There's no denying that there's a nice visual upgrade. Look at that. I mean, it's fantastic looking compared to this. And this was fantastic looking. But ultimately, all this is going to do is, you know, eventually, I mean, that's one of the chase to graphics is ridiculous to me. Because there was a time when you saw this and were like, whoa, that's fucking awesome. And now you see this and go, whoa, that's fucking awesome. And this will be the bargain bin in a year, right? That's, or Jack and Daxter. I'd rather have a Jack and Daxter short or an Uncharted. Yeah, and it seems like the chat agrees. The chat, the polls come out, 22% would rather have this remake. But 78% say no, give us something new. And if I were to have voted, which I didn't, I would agree with that. So, I was just curious. Okay, somebody's saying that Joel looks less masculine. I mean, are we really going there? What's the matter, guys? Do you need a father figure? Is that what's going on? Why is it always about the culture wars? Leave people alone. I guess she looks less feminine. Is that what we're gonna say now? God damn, just go fucking get a Hustler magazine or a web, go to Pornhub and be done with it. I mean, to be fair, I'd fuck her before I'd fuck her. Not that she would fuck me either way, but I'm saying, do I think she looks more cute? Like, what's that woman's name who's in the, she dates the Batman. What's that lady's name in real life? She was, in the Twilight motion picture shows, that thing. She looks more like that. Here, she just looks a little worn down. Auntie G says Joel's hot. Okay, Auntie G, if you were given the choice to have the sexy time with... Okay, here we're going to do it. We're going to do another poll. We're doing another poll real quick. Okay. Not Natalie Portman. Kristen Stewart is her name. Kristen Stewart. Who would you fuck? I'll put the Nathan Drake, the Joel first for Auntie. I'll say PS4 Joel or PS5 Joel. Here we go. I'm going to hold my breath for 30 seconds and then we're going to see who the more fuckable version of Joel is first. Here we go. Answer the poll. I'll be right back. I think I'll just do it for as long as I can hold my breath. So vote fast because I can't hold it very long. I mean, if it takes you, how long does it fucking take you to vote? Just fucking vote.
I don't like to vote. It's all the same. Everyone's the same, no matter who wins.
Okay, so the answer is, it's not 50-50, but it's close. The PS4 Joel is more fuckable. According to the chat. I wonder why. Is it because he does look softer, quote, less feminine, as someone said, and he's more rugged here? Now let's do it here. And I'll vote on this one. I don't know, what's his character called? Which lady would you sexy time with? Oh, it's because the other one looks older. Okay, so... this says PS, I'll just say, red girl, cause she's wearing a red shirt, and, wine girl, right? Cause the wine, this is the older one over here. The newer one, sorry, is wine. And this is red. That's terrible. Cause it's actually, it doesn't matter. You know what I'm saying? I could just say left or right. I could just say left or right. Jeffy, you're an idiot. Left girl. Tess. I don't fucking know who Tess is. Right girl. Okay, here we go. Ask the community. Okay, I'm not going to tell you who, but I'm going to vote on this one. Oh, it doesn't even let me vote. Okay, I can't vote on my own polls. Okay. All right, here we go. I'm going to hold my breath as long as I can. The left girl, 82%. You goddamn right. 83%. You goddamn right. So I don't know anything about, I don't know if that says anything other than, hey, if these characters come to life. Yeah, it's just an age thing. Isn't that interesting? Because she does look like mid-20s, early 20s even. She looks like she's 44. And there's nothing wrong with 44 or 23 or whatever. It's just interesting that a better looking at a technical level version of this character would change their age. Isn't that interesting? Anyway, that's, you know, what do you think? You think it's going to be a big sales hit or not? That's what I want to know. I'm sure it will do well, but I mean, isn't there a point where the customer finally comes and says, look, we've played the game enough. We're done. And maybe Jim Ryan's answer is yeah, but there's a whole new audience coming in from HBO. And there's a whole new audience of people coming into the ecosystem. because of the new PS Plus or you know, whatever. And perhaps Jim Ryan's like, okay, don't buy it again. We got God of War for you coming on. And I'm like, okay, I could see that. I mean, again, these Sony for all their, you know, trip ups from time to time, like any company, is a smart company. So it's not like they don't know what the fuck they're doing. So we'll see where things, we'll see where it takes us, fellas. All right. Where did that go? Where did that go? Hang on. $50 it sells. Master Luke says $80 it won't. Is that, have they released a price for this thing yet? Have they said how much it actually is? Yeah, I am looking forward to Stray next week. Absolutely. Check it out, Masochista. Thank you, buddy. He's been a member for 4 months. He says, I love The Last of Us, but I'll wait for this remake to be on PS Plus. I probably will as well. But thank you for that, Masochista. And also, fellas, thank you for being here for the Gabbin' and Games Live. I appreciate it. Tomorrow or the next day will be a solo Gabbin' and Games flight. It'll just be me without an audience talking about the news of the day. But we'll be back again at least one more time this week with the Gabbin' and Games Live. I'll also be over on the Discord and on the Twitter, and you can find me here at YouTube, and I'll be streaming some games, blah, 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 blah. In the meantime, be well, be safe. Thank you for joining me. All the new members, welcome. We will be playing The Quarry this week with members as well. I just got to figure out the right time. Sorry about that. Yeah, exactly. Crip says smash the like button like you would smash a virtual character. That's right. I appreciate it, buddy. And that's it. I'm off like a dirty shirt. I'll see you guys really, really soon. Bye, everybody. And watch the ad. Come on, man. Or don't. But at least tell your friends. Tell your friends, hey, I like this show. If you like it. All right, I'm out. See you, fellas. Thank you, Auntie G. I appreciate it, buddy.